But first, over the past 18 months, you might have noticed that Joe Biden and the climate cult alarmists who control him sometimes pretend that they think they have a monopoly of compassion. They feel your pain. In reality, they want you to feel pain. They want it. Joe promised it. He's delivering. They want you to pay more at the pump. They want your energy bills to be higher. They want food prices to rise. They want you to make do with less, all in the name of climate change. Now, according to them, the administration must take extreme measures right now in order to save Mother Earth from imminent doom. Now, ultimately, this is nothing more than window dressing. In other words, a huge Trojan horse for big government socialism. They want to fundamentally transform this country, even if it means your life gets a hell of a lot worse. Now, the climate cult alarmists are waging a war on the American people, on our budgets. They are disproportionately impacting negatively the poor, the middle class, people on fixed income, the elderly in this country. But don't take my word for it. Listen to small town mayor and genius, the man of all experience, Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg. Mayor Pete, look.
The higher the price of gas, then the faster you reach that parity.
Of course, the more pain we are all experiencing from the high price of gas, the more benefit there is for those who can access electric vehicles. It's why we're hoping you and your colleagues might reconsider opposing the reduction of EV upfront prices with tax credits.
So you're saying the more pain we have, the more benefit we're going to get.
Of course.
I think that's what I heard you say. The more pain that we
have. That's what you heard me say.
That's what I heard you say.
I know you want me to say it so bad.
Did you get that? The more pain you experience, the more benefit for electric vehicles. Now, maybe you didn't quite hear it. I think it's worth playing one more time. Pay very close attention and keep in mind Joe Biden promised during the campaign he would eliminate fossil fuels. I guess with the exception, he didn't tell us about the exception for Russia, Iran, Venezuela, OPEC, and Saudi Arabia, but he said he'd eliminate them. Take a look again.
The more pain we are all experiencing from the high price of gas, the more benefit there is for those who can access electric vehicles.
The more pain, the more benefit. Your pain is a good thing, not for you, of course, but for our great transition and those that can afford it. Now, keep in mind, an average electric vehicle, in case you don't know, is over 20 grand more than a gas-powered car, so you're paying a lot more up front. Of course, aside from filling in potholes in South Bend, Indiana, Biden's brilliant transportation secretary doesn't really have much experience in transportation at all. But remember, Mayor Pete wasn't appointed to make our roads and bridges and airports safer and more efficient. No, he's in office to help foster a fundamental transition to this Green New Deal socialist utopia of an economy which we now know is a disaster, which in the end isn't green at all. Electric cars, for example, they're not telling you this part. They don't actually improve the environment. According to a recent study, the brand new Hummer electric vehicle actually produces more carbon emissions than a gas-powered Chevy Malibu. Why is that? Well, first, the battery on an electric vehicle is typically comprised of nickel, cobalt, aluminum, and manganese, all of which need to be mined from Mother Earth with heavy equipment that uses diesel. Second, that battery constantly needs to be plugged in and recharged. Look at that chart right there. Where do we get our energy from? Where's the electricity come from? I bet we don't think about it often. 80% of the power that you use to recharge these electric vehicles comes from oil, gas, and coal. Now, because of the extreme cost to build and operate, along with a very small energy output, wind, solar, and all other forms of so-called renewable energy, they only make up about 12% of our power grid, and they're very unreliable. Ask Texas. For the foreseeable future, a major transition to renewables, even in the near future, the next 10, 15, 20 years, is likely totally impossible. So, in order to maintain the green energy front to this, quote, economic transition, in other words, the pain that you're going to pay for and the pain that's going to cause you and your family, Biden is restricting American domestic fossil fuel production and refinery capacity while attempting to make up the deficit by importing more oil, more gas, the lifeblood of our economy from overseas. Now, the result, an economy and an environment that is suffering. Oil and gas is more expensive. And guess what? When you import it, if it's imported from countries with lax environmental regulations and then shipped in massive gas-powered vessels across the ocean, the climate cult needs to answer one simple question. I wish somebody would ask Joe Biden or Kamala Harris. Please ask this question. Why is it okay to beg Russia, import from Russia, import from Iran, beg Venezuela, beg the Saudi pariah nation of Saudi Arabia, beg the killer of Jamal Khashoggi, according to Joe Biden? Why is it okay to beg OPEC for hundreds and hundreds of millions of barrel of oil so that they will give to us, sell to us at a high rate and get them rich, when we can produce all of it here? We do it faster, we do it cheaper, and guess what? We do it cleaner. Explain all of this insanity to the American people, because they have a right to know at this point, paying record high gas prices and a 41-year high of inflation. But again, the left's climate hysteria, it's really not about the environment, is it? They told us in the beginning, Green New Deal, guaranteed government health care, guaranteed wage, guaranteed job, guaranteed college, guaranteed government healthy food, guaranteed retirement. It's about a transition to socialism. Take a look.
What is the short term and the medium term so that we can make sure we have enough oil and gas to support us through the transition? And what are the kind of steps that we don't want the oil and gas industry to take that would have long term consequences, when we don't want new major projects that would take 20, 30 years to become profitable? So we have to make that differentiation to make sure that the American consumer has what it needs to grow our economy and the global economy, but not take steps and endanger the climate work that we're trying to do to make sure that we're on a better footing to accelerate the transition.
Are you listening to the transition that you're a part of, that you're paying for? That advisor is not the only Biden official talking about an accelerated transition. Take a look for yourself.
The challenge for all of us now is that no one country can solve this problem by itself. We all have to be able to reduce the emissions. We have to accelerate the transition. We're behind. We're not yet fulfilling the promises that we made in Glasgow. So we have our work cut out for us.
More pain, more progress. We have our work cut out for us. Word of the day, transition, transition. When someone tells you that they're going to do something, like Joe Biden said, I'm going to eliminate it, I'm going to get rid of fossil fuels, next time you need to believe them. Even better, actions usually speak louder than words. Now, if it's the ice caps they're claiming are melting and the sea levels are rising at an unsustainable level, why did Obama and Biden, both of them, just shell out millions and millions of dollars for beachfront homes? Now, if the planet is now facing imminent destruction, then why does Biden's special envoy for the climate, John, I voted for the $87 billion before I voted against it, Kerry, why does he own and operate a massive private jet? I don't care that he has one, but he's a hypocrite. Kerry's Gulfstream made 48 trips since Biden took office, emitting over 300 metric tons of carbon. That's more than you'll probably use in a lifetime. Now, if this truly is a crisis, why isn't John leading by example, giving up his private jet? Maybe he can sell them on the free market and get good deals for other people. But don't worry, in his upcoming international trip to the White House on climate, a Kerry spokesperson is telling FoxNews.com that the climate czar might actually fly in a government jet instead. That's right. In the midst of this so-called climate crisis, our federal government, your government that's putting all this pain on you and your families, they continue to own and operate a massive fleet of passenger jets that they use to ferry around all these cabinet and government officials and other government VIPs. All told, your federal government, they own a whopping 924 aircraft across 11 agencies, 500 planes, most of them jets, over 400 helicopters. Now think about it. Your federal government is asking you to drive less, fly less, eat less, suffer in silence, pay astronomical rates for a gallon of gasoline, one record high after another, all because of the urgent climate emergency and the need to transition. And they jet all over the world in a massive fleet of government aircraft that you pay for, and you pay for the jet fuel as well. which of course leaves a huge carbon footprint that they say that they're against, that they don't even want out of your SUV. And they want you to buy an electric vehicle that you can't afford and, by the way, costs four times the amount of gasoline that you're paying now. We're talking about more than $600 million for government aircraft every single year, for their private jets, for their helicopters. You buy them, you pay for them, they fly in them, but then they lecture you. Let me state the obvious. Climate change is not a national emergency. It is not a crisis. We're not facing imminent doom or extinction. They don't have anything to transition to. And thank God, because the federal government is not doing anything to improve the environment. By the way, Donald Trump made us energy independent. And oh, guess what? Out of the industrialized world, we reduce carbon emissions more than anybody. The real danger here is the left's attempt to grab power with the hope of transforming our economy into their top-down, government-controlled, socialist hellhole. So when someone tells you the sky is falling and we have just 12 years to save Mother Earth, but they won't produce energy here domestically, but they'll take it from the Russians and the Iranians and the Venezuelans and the Saudis and OPEC, just know they're either delusional or they have ulterior motives. Hey, Sean Hannity here. Hey, click here to subscribe to Fox News YouTube page and catch our hottest interviews and most compelling analysis. You will not get it anywhere else.